Vegas Bell.
There is sound. Welcome to everyone here in this university hall, het Academiegebouw Utrecht University. I am very pleased to be able to welcome you today on the occasion of the start of the academic year. We will soon be announcing the winners of the Students Awards, and I'm really looking forward to it, although you are sitting in some kind of an examination position, I think. But it's fine that you have that you are here in this building. The fact that we have to keep our distance is, of course, a pity. So is the fact that fewer people can be present than we would have liked. But until recently, this entire place was shut down. So this is already a big improvement. And fortunately, all the friends, family, and other interested parties can follow what is happening here via the live stream. I would also like them to wish them a warm welcome. The start of the academic year is totally different from that of previous years. We normally celebrate this festive occasion 100 meters away in another venue in a packed dorm church somewhere over there. But this is currently not possible. So the question a month or two ago was, what is possible? What would be possible? Will we do it completely digitally? After all, over the past few months, we have realized just how many things are possible online. The way in which teachers switched to online education in mid-March, in just a few days, when that suddenly became the only option available to reach students, was phenomenal. So was the way in which students responded, by the way. They developed so many wonderful initiatives. We have learned a great deal since then, and we are getting better and better in online interaction. These lessons are of a lasting value. But at the same time, and more than ever in recent months, we have noticed that meeting each other in the flesh, in the classroom, on campus, is also crucial for good education. Just as it is essential for researchers and other colleagues to meet up, eye contact, a gesture, experiencing how a comment is received, all these things simply cannot be replaced by a video call. It is precisely during this crisis that we have realized more than ever that our strength as Utrecht University lies in our community, in our people, in their relationships. We are a world-class university with a heart, and this is something that we want to cherish. As a result, we decided to spend the whole day using this academy building to bring together the people who, together, form the heart of our university. And it goes without saying that students play a very crucial role here. You are the future of our university and our society. This is reflected in the achievements for which today's candidates have been nominated. They have produced a wonderful thesis or wonderful initiatives. You are researchers working on solutions to major issues, bridging the gap between academia and society, working on sustainability and improving academic practice itself. Together, your work and efforts form a kind of kaleidoscope. A kaleidoscope of expertise, resourcefulness, commitment, and great talent. As the executive board, we are extremely proud of you all, proud of all nominees, And it's very important not to forget this. We're proud of you all, even if you don't receive an award today. I would now like to move on to the official part. The Exceptional Extracurricular Achievements Award is presented exclusively to outstanding students who have also pursued substantive endeavors outside their studies. This award sets a high bar. Not only must a student demonstrate strong academic results, he or she must also find the time and energy and possess the talent to make substantial contributions in the social or administrative area. This year, 9 candidates were nominated for this award. The jury, presided by Professor Dov Beer, narrowed this number down to 3. They are Domcast, Journal of Trial and Error, Jote, and Bagheinov Community Composting. And the nominees are presented in the following brief video. If all goes well.
Nou, ik ben Robert Haaks en ik vertegenwoordig Domcast Uitzicht op het Verleden.
Hi, I'm Claire Depy and I represent the Bagheinov Community Composting.
My name is Martijn van der Meer and I represent the project team of the Journal of Trial and Error.
Domcast is een podcast die is gemaakt door 11 studenten. In de podcast behandelen we de geschiedenis van Utrecht aan de hand van vragen van inwoners van Utrecht. En door middel van archiefonderzoek, interviews met experts, met de hulp van Utrechters zelf, proberen we een nieuw licht te schijnen op de geschiedenis van onze stad. En tegelijkertijd proberen we onze luisteraars een kijkje te geven in en te betrekken bij het doen van historisch onderzoek, om zo de kloof tussen de universiteit en de stad te verkleinen.
So we collect thousands of liters of organic food waste from 130 people in a local cafe. This allows us to create high quality compost, which is then offered to communal gardens. This social environmental initiative has proven that social action can have an extraordinary impact on the environment and the strengthening of social networks.
Yeah. First worm, going.
We aim to bridge the gap between what is researched and what is published. By synchronizing academic practice with academic publications, we aim to rethink scientific success. We think of failure as just an individual experience. With our emphasis on the community aspect of academia, we hope to encourage a less competitive and more altruistic science. This results, we believe, in a more transparent, effective, open and friendly research climate.
Er staat nog niks vast. Velen van ons zullen hun horizon met nieuwe plannen en ambitie verzetten. Maar we hopen wel dat dit project het begin zal zijn van een langdurige traditie waarbij elk jaar studenten de samenwerking aangaan met Utrechters om de onuitputtelijke bron van historische verhalen over de stad aan het licht te brengen.
So a new team has been established for fall 2020 and they will work on the expansion of this project. For example, they aim to collect food waste from about 200 people and to involve more local cafes and stakeholders.
Our ambition is to spread our gospel of open, reflective and altruistic science at conferences, seminars and other events. We've already successfully integrated our publishing platform with research databases such as Google Scholar and WorldCat and continue to experiment with cutting-edge publication technologies such as dynamic publishing and post-publication peer review. Over a couple of years, we've ensured that academic success is solely understood on the level of the academic community.
I would like to invite two members of Domcast to join me on stage. Don't fight. Yeah, two. Okay, and please take into account the appropriate distance from each other. Okay. This year, the jury received 9 nominations. The 3 nominees have undertaken interesting but very different activities. Their projects make fascinating reading, but also made it difficult to choose a winner. Nevertheless, the jury has decided unanimously to award this student prize for special merits to the students of the podcast project Domcast. Since February, 11 students from various study programs of the Faculty of Humanities have dedicated themselves to making a series of podcasts about the personal history of a number of Utrecht residents. The podcast, which is supported by the community program, community engaged learning program, was originally an internship project, but is now much more than that. With inspiring energy and motivations, the students set to work on the social project. Residents were encouraged to send in questions about the history of Utrecht, after which the students researched the answers to these questions. An important part of the project focused on the question how about the unknown identity of a Jewish family. The group gave this family a voice based on correspondence they found in the archives of the Jewish Cultural Quarter. Now the students are investigating whether they can have a lasting memorial to this family in the Jan van Skorrelstraat, a so-called Stolperstein. This highlights the connection between the project, Utrecht, and its impact in the city. The jury was impressed by the enthusiasm, ingenuity, involvement, and perseverance of the students. They have shown other students how inspiring and engaging research can be. What also appeals to the jury is that Domcast continued their activities during the Corona crisis and continued to produce the podcast despite the current situation. Domcast has the potential to grow. Continuity is desired, and the jury hopes that Domcast will be a permanent feature within the university. This project will make it possible for successive groups of students to investigate the local history of Utrecht, providing a lasting link between the city and the university. In awarding this prize, the jury takes great pleasure in putting these enthusiastic students and their commitment to the local history of Utrecht in the spotlight. Congratulations. It's a pity that I cannot give you the flowers and the gift, which is a personalized hoodie in person, but they will be waiting for you when you leave the aula. But before we do that, there are some questions still pending, of course. In the nomination to the state that you were looking for the possibility to create a Stolperstein. How is it? How does the project stand when it comes to that respect? Will there be a possibility to have a Stolperstein in the Jan van Skorrelstraat? What do you think?
Well,
you can stand a bit closer to the microphone.
Well, me and another attorney were looking into that. And as of now, we don't really have a response of the family living in the house right now. But yeah, we think it could be possible. I heard that there's one person designing those Stolpersteine. There's one German man that does that. And he, of course, has a lot of projects all through Europe, mostly placing those stones. Yeah, we hope it could be a possibility, and maybe we can reach out to the gemeente. But I don't know really how it works, because that man has to design them personally. But yeah, it would be really, really great to have a lasting memory for that family.
Yeah, perhaps you should start a podcast about how to create a Stolperstein, for instance.
That could be an interesting. Yeah, we were looking into that, and so maybe we have some ideas. It's not really clear yet, but some ideas of looking into that. Yeah.
And a final question. You said something already, something about it in the video, but it was created some time ago. How does the future look like when it comes to Domcast? Will there be continuity? What is necessary for creating continuity?
Well, that depends. For example, we all have really different, because we are from so many different places within the humanities. We really have a different take on that, I think, for everyone. Mm-hmm. But we only answered, I think, about 10 or 11 questions, and we received about 80 of them. So, of course, there is a lot of stuff you can look into, and there's a lot of questions still there. And as a project, it can last, I think, because even if it won't be us, for example, it could be other people looking into it, because now we have set a means of how to do it.
So there is work for years to come, and I think that the new generations of students can also profit from what
you've done. Yes.
Okay, thank you very much. A big hand of applause for that. Please step down. I would like to ask the other nominees from the Journal of Trial and Error and the Bahrain of Community Composting to stand up. And please give them also a warm round of applause. Please show yourself. And also for you, the flowers and the hoodies are waiting for you somewhere on the end of the aula. Thank you very much. Then we proceed to the Best Thesis Award. The Executive Board has instituted this award to honor the student who wrote the best master thesis in the previous year. Some submissions are reviewed by a jury representing a broad spectrum of fields and chaired by Professor Peter Driessen. This year, 28 outstanding theses receiving marks of 8.5 or higher were submitted to the jury. As in previous years, the jury was impressed by the exceptionally high level of the submissions. Many of these theses, this year's theses, also impressed in terms of their overall societal relevance. Moreover, each of the nominated students utilize every opportunity to achieve their own full potential and to contribute to a better world. In reviewing nominations, the jury's main assessment criterion is the quality of each thesis. It must constitute original research, illuminated in an engaging style that is also comprehensible for non-specialists. By presenting this award, our university wishes to not only honor, but also stimulate promising research talent. Although the overall quality of thesis at Utrecht University is already very high, the jury managed to narrow down the nominations for the Best Master Thesis Award to 3 students, and the nominees are presented in the following brief video.
I'm Erikos Kunalis, and the title of my thesis is Combining Metal-Metal and Metal-Ligand Cooperativity Using an Ethyridine-Based Proton-Responsive PMMP Transcranial Thinser.
Ik ben Marit Woudwijk en de titel van mijn scriptie is The Lesser Truth, Truth Construction on Remote Warfare and the Case of the US-led Anti-ISIS Coalition in Syria.
My name is Arif Ibrahim Ardisasmita. The title of my thesis is Hepatocyte in Vitro Model, Maturation and Monogenic Liver Disease Modeling.
My thesis was inspired by nature, and I set out to develop a molecule that could combine the interaction between multiple metals and the interaction between the metals and the ligand. Doing this, I synthesized a couple new compounds that showed some unique geometries and are also possible candidates to catalyze various reactions that might be useful in the pharmaceutical industry.
Mijn scriptie gaat over hedendaagse oorlogsvoering. En hoe deze oorlog vandaag de dag eigenlijk steeds vaker op afstand wordt gevoerd. Bijvoorbeeld met de inzet van drones en precisiewapens. Deze remote wars of lange afstandsoorlogen worden vaak gerepresenteerd alsof ze levens redden. Zowel van militairen die niet meer in het slagveld aanwezig zijn, maar ook van burgers op de grond. Nou, mijn scriptie kijkt naar hoe deze representatie van oorlog juist tegengesproken wordt door burgers die in het slagveld moeten leven. En het gaat over hun ervaringen met deze precisiebombardementen.
In my thesis, I compiled all liver infiltrator models that have been developed. I compared them to each other and also to actual human liver cells. The strengths and weaknesses of each liver in vitro model were also presented, and I hope this thesis may help researchers to determine which in vitro model is most suited for their research, and ultimately help the development of novel therapies which may benefit the patients in the future.
I got offered a PhD position on a project related to my master's thesis, and starting August 15th, I will be a PhD candidate at Utrecht University.
Ik begin in september met een PhD-onderzoek, waarin ik onderzoek ga doen naar erkenning voor slachtoffers van Nederlandse militaire missies. Dus eigenlijk waar mijn onderzoek is gestopt, pak ik dat nu verder op en ga ik de vraag stellen, oké, maar hoe kunnen we nu ervoor zorgen dat er gerechtigheid komt voor de slachtoffers van deze militaire missies?
I have been given an opportunity to work as a PhD candidate from my supervisor, during which I plan to develop this thesis further using more data and analysis. Eventually, I want to publish it because this thesis will help nobody if it is not open for other people, especially other researchers, to see.
What a great day it is for the humanities, eh? Yeah, great. Yeah, well, dear Marit, during the deliberations of the jury, it became quickly clear that your thesis stood out in particular because of the subject itself, the relevance of the subject, and the way you handled your research methodologically, theoretically, and analytically. Students within the MA program, Conflict Studies and Human Rights, often conduct fieldwork in dangerous places, countries where conflict and violence are highly prevalent, areas that are recovering from war and terror. However, you chose not to travel to a war zone or a conflict area, but to stay in the Netherlands and to do research on remote warfare and the interpretation of this type of war by those who lived amongst it. Contemporary wars are often remote wars by using drones and precision weapons and by targeting specific locations. These wars seem to save lives, so to say, legitimizing the use of force and violence. In your thesis, you look at the interpretations of Syrians who currently live in the Netherlands of the airstrikes by the US-led anti-ISIS coalition between 2014 and 2018. You relate these interpretations to the regimes of truth on this war that are prevalent within Dutch society. And from the point of view of the survivors, what stories can be told or should be silenced when you survived the bombardments of Raqqa and now live in a country that was actively involved in these bombardments? Your research reveals the construction of a lesser truth, a truth that fits a society which was actively involved in this violence. By doing so, you not only give a voice to a silent issue, but also you critically confront Dutch citizens with our own violence. In the words of your supervisor, Jolla Demmers, here on stage, you succeeded fully. I quote her, "Marit demonstrates a very good capacity to synthesize, using both inductive and deductive analysis. Her argumentation is lucid, coherent, and convincing. In addition, she capably blends in the voices of her informants throughout the analysis, creating an inciting narrative and bringing to life their everyday struggles while keeping a balanced analytical distance." End of quote. Currently, you lecture within Taal and Cultuur Studies and with Media and Culture Studies. And besides that, you continue your research, as was shown in the video, within the project Intimacies of Remote Warfare, which enhances research and distributes findings on contemporary remote warfare. You presented two papers on the subject of your thesis at a seminar and an international conference, and reached a wide audience by your article in The Correspondent. It is very clear that you have a very promising career laying ahead of you, and the members of the jury do not doubt that you successfully will live up to that. Congratulations. Some months ago we met for the first time, and I also already confronted you with the question, did you really go back to the people that you interviewed? And you told me, of course, what you did, but I think that for the wider audience it's also very interesting to hear what your experience was when you went back to the people you interviewed and what they thought about your work.
Thank you very much for your kind words. It was difficult to reach out to some of my informants, as we say that in anthropological terms, because I just lost touch with some of them. When the article at The Correspondent was published, that was quite a big thing for a lot of my research participants and informants, because they really wanted the Dutch people to know about their story, about their history, and about the effect of Dutch bombs in Syria. So, that was something that my research participants were glad with, that word was out. Still, they were like, it's not enough. More people need to know. It need to come into politics. That's something that I don't see as my job, at least not at this moment. That's something I can say about that.
Whenever there's a time that it's safe in Raqqa once again, do you intend to go there to see for yourself what the situation was there?
Yeah, let's hope that is going to be possible.
That's not in the foreseeable future.
In the foreseeable future. Well, yeah, that was... I wanted to do research on these bombardments that have been carried out in Syria, but also in Iraq. I had the restrictions that I couldn't go there, and that kind of like formed my research. I think in the end it was really kind of like good restriction also for me to just stay here in the Netherlands, stay in place, and just look around me and see what was happening here and what kind of stories I could find here. I do really think that it's important for me also to go there once it's going to be safe. Because I do really see the importance of doing research and also see a place for yourself, speak to the people, know what you're talking about. And now my research context was the Netherlands, so it was the case to stay here, but I wouldn't really want to go.
There was already a publication in The Correspondent about your... Do you intend to publish the entire work in the near future? Is there a possibility for it?
I was intending to do so. Now I'm going to start a new research project. I'm not sure if that's still going to happen because I also need to focus on following publications. But I hope to kind of like weave my previous research into the thing I'm going to do.
We should have a brief discussion during the reception, I think. Hey, thank you very much. Great.
Thank you.
And of course, I would like the two other nominees, Arif Ibrahim Arizdasmita and Erikos Kunalis, to stand up. Please show yourself. You also did a wonderful job. And of course, the flowers and the hoodies are waiting for you after this ceremony. So that brings me to the end of the ceremony. I'd like to thank everyone here for being here, as well as the family, friends, colleagues, and other interested parties who watch the live stream or see it on video sometime in the near future. The reception will take place at the faculty club. And at the faculty club, we are offered snacks and drinks. And of course, due to the corona regulations, everyone must sit at the tables there. Okay, let's see each other again at in the faculty club. And we, as professors, we will start the ceremony, we walk out, and then please join in. Yeah? Okay. See each other, well, in a few minutes then. Yeah? Okay. Please.